Welcome, everyone, to another GIA Knowledge Session, a series of talks and seminars about gemology fueled by our decades of research. I'm Evan Smith, your host for today. Natural blue diamonds are among the most valuable and famous of fancy colored diamonds. From the Hope diamond with its fiery phosphorescence to hydrogen-rich diamonds with their intriguing Alexandrite effect, blue diamonds have always captured our imagination. Today, here to give us a complete rundown of blue diamonds and some of the stories behind these captivating gemstones is Dr. Sally Magaña, Senior Manager of Diamond Identification at GIA. Now, before we get started, a reminder that everyone in the audience is automatically muted. And if you have a question, please type it in using the Q&A feature you'll see at the bottom of the screen. There'll be a Q&A session at the end where Dr. Magaña will have the chance to answer some of your questions. We'll also send a recording of the session to you later today. That message will have a survey where we'd love to hear some of your feedback. And with that, I'll pass it over to you, Dr. Sally Magaña.
Hello, everyone. Today we'll be discussing natural blue diamonds along with their cousins, the violet and the gray diamonds. I want to start off by showing some of the most beautiful diamonds that we see here and that have been produced within this color range. We have the Blue Moon of Josephine, we have the Blue Heart, we have the Hope Diamond, the Wittelsbach Graph. These are just some of the amazing diamonds that have been produced by nature within this color range. For today's talk, I will be looking first at some of the general characteristics and the grading quality factors of blue, gray, and violet diamonds. I'll be discussing the four major causes of color in these diamonds, such as boron, hydrogen impurities, irradiation, and the presence of micro inclusions. And then at the end, I'll be giving a comparison among these four causes. I'm going to talk first about the color distribution that we see among diamonds that have been submitted to GIA. These were surveyed over about a 10-year period from 2008 to 2018, and we compiled all of these data and chronicled their properties. So for all of the diamonds within this color range, about 38% have a pure blue hue. About another 15% have a gray-blue to blue-gray coloration. About one-third are a straight gray color. About 4% have a violet color, and then the remaining are green-blue or greenish-blue. Looking at the weight distribution for these diamonds, we can see immediately that the vast majority of them are less than 1 carat in weight. We do see that there are some, these data are separated by 1/10 carat increments, and we can see that there are some spikes at around 1 carat, 1.5 carats, 2 carats, and so on, where these are weight thresholds that the polisher will try to achieve. And so we do see some spikes there, but the vast majority of the diamonds are less than 1 carat. We are also dividing these diamonds up by hue. And so we can see that across the weight range, most of the diamonds are roughly well represented across the entire weights. However, for those that are predominantly violet in color, we typically see those only at the very smallest weights. So most violet diamonds have carat weights of about less than 0.5 carat. This plot shows the shape distribution for diamonds that have been submitted to GIA. The majority of them are fancy shapes. The polishers will generally decide to have it as fancy shape in order to maximize the face-up color or because of the shape of the irregular rough, in which a fancy shape might be a better choice than a round. This slide shows the color distribution for the four major causes of color, and we will go through all of these. Firstly, we have color due to boron, in which we can see the color increase from a very light saturation to a very intense saturation as the boron concentration increases. We can also see an increasing amount of gray. We can see some gray components in these diamonds as well. And that's due to plastic deformation. In stones that are colored yellow or pink, if there's plastic deformation in those diamonds, we'll generally see that as a brown coloration. But in blue diamonds, the effect of plastic deformation gives the diamond a more grayish color. So we can see both of these contributions within the boron-containing or the type 2B diamonds. In those that are colored due to hydrogen defects, we can see increasing amount of color saturation. We can also see a variation between a pure gray color or a combination of gray and blue. And sometimes we also see a violet coloration as well in the graded color of these diamonds. And those that are colored due to GR1, due to irradiation, we can see those that have very faint saturation colors, such as light blue. And as we increase in the color saturation, we can start to see a lot of green-blue colors as well. The straight blues that we see within those that are colored by GR1 generally have very light saturations. If we see some vivid colors, it's generally that we only see those as a green-blue appearance. And then finally, those that are colored due to inclusions. Those are pretty much exclusively have a gray color, and we can see a difference in the color saturations from, say, faint to light gray. We can also see a difference in the transparency. Some of these have so many inclusions that they will appear translucent to our eye. Since we will be looking at a number of absorption spectra today, I wanted to first run through an example of absorption spectrum and explain what it is that we're looking at in each within these plots. So along the x-axis, we are showing the wavelength, starting at low wavelengths that are violet in color, and then going up the rainbow into the red at the much higher wavelengths. Along the y-axis, we're showing the absorbance. As we go up on the y-axis, we're seeing increased amount of absorbance. And as we go down on the y-axis, we're seeing increased amount of transparency. So if we want to know what the color of the diamond is, we're going to look for those valleys. We're going to look for what we call a transmission window, which for this diamond happens to be within the green to blue range. If we want to know what are the defects, what are the optical centers that are contributing to the color, then we're going to look at the peaks. So here we have an N3 peak, and then over here we have a very strong GR1 with its sideband creating a very broad absorption from about 550 nanometers all the way up through the red, creating that transmission window within the green to blue. So here we're showing absorption spectra for the four major causes of color. For boron, it looks relatively featureless. All we see is a relatively straight line slope going from the infrared into the red, creating a transmission window within the blue. For those diamonds that are colored by hydrogen, we see a diagnostic peak for hydrogen that's spanned at 835. We see that in a lot of diamonds that are colored by hydrogen, not just those that are in this blue, gray, violet color range, but we can also see these very pronounced bands at about 520 nanometers and about 720 nanometers that help create that transmission window within the blue. For those that are colored by GR1, we see this, as we mentioned on the last slide, we have a very pronounced peak at 740 nanometers associated with that irradiation. And we have not much absorption within the blue, creating that transmission window for this diamond within the blue region. Now for inclusions, those aren't getting their color from atomic level defects like the others spectra on the screen. So for this, we're not looking so much at the absorption spectra as so much as what's in the microscope. And we'll talk about those more later on. Now on this slide, we're looking at a number of defects that are named here. And I'm going to take a brief segue and talk about the naming of these optical centers. In my last talk, when I was discussing pink diamonds, one of the submitted questions was asking about this naming convention. And so I wanted to spend a few minutes just to discuss that, to try and help clear up any misconceptions about these. because the names of diamond defects actually are a rather confusing mix of historical designations that go back several decades, and then some more recent names that are based on atomic configurations. For example, the N in N3 and other defects such as N2, it stands for natural. It does not stand for nitrogen. It happens to contain nitrogen, but when it was named, it didn't know that the scientists didn't know that at the time. So it does stand for natural. And it is coincidence that the N3 center does have three nitrogens in a vacancy. Similarly, the H in H3 and other defects such as H2 and H4, it stands for heated. It doesn't stand for hydrogen. Its composition is two nitrogens in a vacancy. And so the H3 that we talk about a lot as well, it is a nitrogen related defect. Meanwhile, the N in the NV center, that N does stand for nitrogen. And the GR1 that we showed on the last slide, that stands for general radiation 1. And there's also several other peaks that are that you can see in an irradiated spectrum. Those are termed GR2, GR3, so on to GR8, but we don't really speak about those too much. We mostly focus on the GR1 peak at 740 nanometers. So where did all this come from? Well, decades ago, many centers were seen in the absorption spectra of natural and of heated diamonds. And the researchers observed those on the absorption spectra and just designated the peaks across the spectra as 1, 2, 3, et cetera. And these defects, most of these defects are now identified. We now know the composition of the N3 defect. There's also other defects within these series as well. There's an N1 and N2 and N3 on out to N5. And some of the heated centers, such as H3, are also detected in natural unheated diamonds. So I just wanted to spend a few minutes just to try and hopefully clear up any misconceptions that there may be about this defect naming. I'm gonna go back from that tangent and get back to our beautiful blue diamonds. And I'm gonna talk first about those that have color due to boron. Now, when we talk about diamonds that have color due to boron, we also refer to them as type 2B. That's pretty much the definition of what a type 2B diamond is. It's a diamond that has no detectable nitrogen, but it does have boron within its infrared absorption spectra, namely this peak at 2800 wave numbers. And this peak can tell us a lot of things about the diamond. First of all, its area, the area under this curve, can be used to directly calculate what the boron concentration is that is affecting the color. For example, this bottom spectrum has a calculated value of uncompensated boron of about 30 parts per billion, and it's a colorless diamond. It's a decolored diamond. This middle IR spectrum, it has a slightly larger boron-related peak, and that calculates out to 140 parts per billion, and you can see it's about a fancy light blue. This top spectrum, the peak of 2800 is so large that it saturates the detector, and so in order to calculate the concentration for that, we use instead a feature that develops in the very highly concentrated boron diamonds that's over at 1280 nanometers. And the interesting thing about this peak is that this directly leads to the color that we see within the visible range. The intensity of this peak helps create this downward slope that goes from the infrared into the near infrared in the red that creates that absorption in the red and the transmission window within the blue. So the steeper the slope that we see within the infrared, the steeper the slope we will see within the visible spectrum and the more intense blue color we will see. Another thing I want to mention is that what we are looking at and what we are measuring here within the infrared, it's not the total boron concentration, it's what we call the uncompensated. That boron that has not been electrically compensated by other defects or other impurities that are in the diamond. If we wanted to know the total boron concentration, that's some value greater, and that can be determined by counting the boron atoms using a method such as SIMS, which is secondary ion mass spectroscopy, that counts the boron atoms. And so that would give you the total boron concentration. So for example, this top diamond that has a uncompensated boron value of 700 parts per billion, that's what we is electrically active and optically active, and what we are able to see that affects the color, but it is not the total boron concentration. And as I mentioned, the slope that we see within the infrared absorption spectra, that continues down from the infrared and from the mid-infrared into the near and then into the red, creating this transmission window within the blue. And again, the steeper that slope, the more intense the blue color is that we see. So one of the most interesting parts of these type 2B diamonds is their phosphorescence. And when we look at the phosphorescence, we can look at it and see it visually. We can also collect spectra and see where this phosphorescence is occurring. And so that's what I'm showing on these bottom graphs. I'm showing a collection of spectra that were taken 1 second apart. And you can see that at the initial time, right after we turn off the ultraviolet light, we see the phosphorescence as the most intense. And then as we continue to have the ultraviolet light off and we're continuing to collect data, we can see that phosphorescence intensity decay. And we can see that for this blue phosphorescence, it is centered at around 500 nanometers. Now for diamonds that show the red phosphorescence, we see a similar pattern in which we, right after we turn off the ultraviolet light, we can see that peak centered at around 660 nanometers. And we can also see that to decay as well. And most type 2B diamonds show either the blue band or the red band, or they show a combination of them both. One famous example of a diamond that shows both the blue and the red is the Hope Diamond. And it has a very famous fiery red phosphorescence. But when you are seeing it actually phosphoresce, you can see that it starts out as an orangey red color due to the blue contribution of, due to the contribution of the blue band. And then as that decays away, you can see the color transition from an orangey red to a red color, which then continues to persist for about a minute. And this photo on the upper left shows us when we were collecting the phosphorescence spectra on the Hope Diamond about 15 years ago. And so this is the phosphorescence spectrum that we collected for the Hope Diamond. And we were able to calculate out the decay times for these phosphorescence. Now decay time just means the amount of time it takes for the intensity to reduce by one half. So for the 500 nanometer peak for the Hope, we saw it as about 2 seconds. And for the blue band, I'm sorry, for the red band, we saw the decay is about 8 seconds. And we also looked at many other blue diamonds that have been show phosphorescence over the years. And for all of these diamonds, the blue band always decays away faster than the red band. We're not fully sure why that happens. That's one of the mysteries. We also saw that the ratio between these is pretty well constant. You can see that the decay time for the 660 band is about 4 times longer than for the 400, for the 500. And that's pretty much what we see, that it's usually about 4 times the decay time for the red compared to the blue. This is another example of a blue diamond in which the blue phosphorescence starts out as greater than the red. And for this diamond, we can see that progression in the phosphorescence. We can see that it starts out as a blue color. And then as that blue phosphorescence band decays away, like it shows in this plot, we can see that color transition to pink and then to red, and then finally the red decays away. In this plot in the upper right-hand corner, what this is showing is a survey of what sort of phosphorescence response we see for type 2B diamonds, depending on the body color of the stone, whether it is a straight blue or whether it has a gray coloration or a violet coloration. And what we saw is that the observed phosphorescence, whether we see blue or red, is very dependent on the body color of the stone. Overwhelmingly, the red phosphorescence is far more common in type 2B diamonds that have a gray coloration. For example, the Hope Diamond is a fancy dark grayish blue. So that includes a grayish coloration in its color grade, and it certainly shows a very deep red phosphorescence. So what is happening with these diamonds? What is the mechanism for why we're seeing this phosphorescence? Well, this was first identified about 50 years ago in the 1960s. Some scientists identified that it was a mechanism that they called donor-acceptor pair recombination. And what that is that is an electron donor, which is currently unknown, and an electron acceptor, which we know is boron within the diamond. Those combine and emit a photon, and that photon is the phosphorescence that we see. Okay, so this is showing the equation for the donor-acceptor pair recombination, and in this equation, all values are observed, such as the phosphorescence, or they are known, such as the acceptor energy or the band gap energy, or they can be calculated, such as the energy of the donor level. Therefore, we can place this equation and this mechanism onto an energy diagram. We know the energy levels for these donors. We just don't know what they are yet. For the 500 nanometer band, the blue band, it would make a lot of sense with our observations if the donor was single nitrogen. We detect that in a lot of diamonds. It's far, far more prevalent in HPHT-grown diamonds, which would explain why the 500 nanometer band is so much more intense for HPHT grown synthetics. However, the energy level is too high within the energy diagram. So we need to find the actual donor, which could be something besides single nitrogen, or we need to find a compelling explanation as to why the math doesn't line up for this. I also did want to mention that in natural diamonds, we do see these phosphorescence bands at 500 nanometers and 660 nanometers, and we only see those two combinations. We don't see any other phosphorescence bands within naturally grown diamonds. In HPHT grown diamonds, we do see the 500 nanometer band quite a lot, and in some we also see a different one that is centered at 580 nanometers. It gives an orange phosphorescence. But in naturally grown diamonds, we only see the 500 and the 660. For the donor creating the 660 nanometer band, we are not sure what that is either. We know it's an energy level and that it's probably created by plastic deformation, but beyond that, we're not sure of that at present. So to pursue that in more in depth, we can take advantage of the fact that we have so many of these rare diamonds come through the GIA laboratory. We collect data as part of the grading process and we maintain it in a database. We can then run surveys on all of those data collected to look for patterns across all these rare diamonds. And we can look for trends that would not be possible to look for anywhere else. So that led to the creation of this comparison I'm showing here on the screen. So we took the type 2B diamonds that have been submitted to GIA, and we're looking for trends that we're seeing between among the type 2s. So what we saw was they can be well split into two different groups, and I'm going to show those on the left and the right. So for the colorless to the pure blue diamonds, some of the gemological and spectroscopic properties that we normally see is, for example, in the 514 nanometer photoluminescent spectra, we often see this peak at 648.2 nanometers, and it's been described as this boron interstitial complex. And also for these diamonds, we typically just see blue phosphorescence. And then over for on the right, we show diamonds that have a gray to gray blue color, or they are deeply colored blue, fancy deep, fancy intense. And among those, we often see a much higher prevalence of in the 514 nanometer photoluminescence, we see a peak at 776.4 nanometers. And that's been correlated as a boron vacancy complex. And then in the phosphorescence, we often see only the red band or sometimes the blue. What was interesting was when we look at other data, other features that are seen within these two different categories, is that among the diamonds that are gray to gray blue, we saw a very high concentration of these diamonds having nickel. That is a nickel-related peak at 883, 884 nanometers. within the near infrared. And so that's one thing that we're pursuing, as to try and diagnose what's that donor in the red phosphorescence that we see for these diamonds. So it's an interesting pattern that we can pretty much only see looking at the diamonds that have been submitted to GIA and being able to look across a wide cross section of these very rare diamonds. Now, type 2B diamonds, they are certainly rare, as I mentioned. They're extremely valuable, contain very few inclusions. Type 2B diamonds have been found in multiple cratons. Most of what has been found historically has been in alluvial deposits from the Golconda region. Most of the blue diamonds found today are sourced from the Cullinan mine in South Africa. And a few years ago, my colleague, Dr. Evan Smith, that you met at the beginning, he did a lot of research into the inclusions within these type 2B diamonds. And he showed that these form predominantly within the lower mantle and can be classified as super deep. So that was something very interesting and new that we've learned about these type 2B diamonds within the last few years. I'm now going to progress to diamonds that are colored by hydrogen-related defects. Those that are gray, gray-blue, often have a violet coloration as well. And I just want to mention that the Argyle mine is the only known source for these diamonds. For these hydrogen-rich gray-blue-violet diamonds, the mine is located in northwestern Australia, as you may be aware. This mine will cease operations in the next few weeks. We'll process ore through the end of the year, and closure rehabilitation will continue for several years. So it'll be interesting to document over the next few years what impact that has on being able to see these diamonds continuing to come through our lab and throughout the trade as well. So to discuss these diamonds, I'm going to talk first again about their IR absorption spectrum. And you can probably tell it's very different from the IR absorption spectra that we looked at for the type 2B diamonds. For those, you see no nitrogen, you see a pronounced peak at 2800 that's diagnostic for it. Whereas in these diamonds, we see a lot of nitrogen. In fact, there's so much nitrogen, it's saturating our detector, and we can't even determine what is this concentration or the A to B aggregates for these. We also see over at around 3100 wave numbers, we see very strong hydrogen peaks. And so we see very strong hydrogen in the infrared. We also see hydrogen-related bands within the visible. And so I'm going to compare these blue-violet diamonds against another class of stones that were discussed by my colleague, Dr. Mike Breeding, when he was mentioning green diamonds, because you can see that they have some very similar features. They both have this so-called hydrogen band at 835 nanometers. They both have these bands at about 530 to 720 nanometers, but you can see that in the blue and violet diamonds, it's much more pronounced. It's much more exaggerated in these than in the green diamonds. Also in the green diamonds, you can see these nitrogen-related defects, the N2 and the N3, that causes absorption in the blue, shifting the transmission window for those into the green. We don't have those absorptions within the blue and violet diamonds, so that leaves a transmission window here within the blue. And due to the other bands, we also have a transmission window within the red as well, and I'll be discussing that on the next slides. It is interesting that among the colored diamonds that are from the Argyle mine, such as these blue-violets, and then these green diamonds also colored by the hydrogen, and then last month I spoke about pink diamonds that were from the Argyle mine, the pinks and then these greens, they both have high amounts of nitrogen-related defects that are present within the visible spectrum. The N2, the N3, the pinks had a lot of H3 as well. And we don't see those in the blue and violet diamonds. They certainly have a lot of nitrogen in these stones, as we can see from the infrared absorption, but we're not seeing those nitrogen-related defects within the visible spectrum. Since we do have these two transmission windows within the absorption spectra for these diamonds, that can create a slight Alexandrite effect. And so just to refresh your memory, an Alexandrite effect is a slight shift in the apparent color as you go from one light source to another. So all diamonds graded at GIA are graded under daylight conditions. And so what we see such a high incidence of these diamonds having a graded color of blue, grade of blue. But if you look at a lot of these diamonds in incandescent light, you start to see that violet coloration as well. So even though the graded color is rare for this class of diamonds, you can see a lot under incandescent light. And what is happening is that under daylight, you're is preferentially illuminating within the blue part of the spectrum. That helps accentuate the blue transmission window, which gives you a much bluer color for a diamond as a result. In comparison, in incandescent light, you're seeing far more emphasis on the red portion of the spectrum. And that red light is what's doing more to illuminate the diamond. And so you're getting more of a dominant effect from the red transmission window. And then when that combines with the more subtle contribution for the blue, that's what gives the stone a violet color. This is another interesting diamond in that has so much absorption that face up, the GIA color grade is fancy black. But if you look at it, pavilion side up, and with fiber optic lighting, you can see this intense violet color within the diamond. And this is due to the same mechanism that there's so much hydrogen in these related absorption bands within the stone that it creates a fancy black color, even though the stone has a very intense violet coloration. I'm gonna discuss now diamonds that are colored by GR1. A few months ago, my colleague, Dr. Mike Breeding, gave a extensive talk about green diamonds, and those are also colored by GR1. Today, I'm gonna focus on those that are towards the blue color range instead of those that are green, but I'll explain why we see both. So for diamonds that are colored by the GR1, we can see the color range vary from very unsaturated up to very intense colors. And what is happening in the diamond, as you may remember, is that outside natural radiation, such as diamond being in physical contact with a radioactive grain or radioactive fluids, that will cause a carbon atom to be knocked out of the diamond lattice. And what that does is it creates this GR1 defect, which is a neutral vacancy. It creates this vacancy within the stone, and that causes it to absorb light at wavelengths greater than 550 nanometers. And depending on what else is within the stone, that will determine whether the color that you see is green or blue. And so I'm trying to show that here on this slide. Along the bottom, we have the absorption spectrum for a green diamond. And you can see that all of these stones have the GR1, but what varies to a great extent is what is happening within the blue part of the spectrum. The green diamonds are also showing this nitrogen-related absorption within the blue part of the spectrum. And so that shifts the transmission window over into the green. And since the vast majority of natural diamonds are going to have this nitrogen-related absorption within the blue, that is what shifts the transmission window into the green for so many of the naturally irradiated diamonds. In order to have a blue color, the natural diamond has to not have that nitrogen. And that's a very small percentage compared to those that do have the nitrogen absorption. And so that's why we're seeing this color difference as we see the influence of the nitrogen. We can see that the color, apparent color, will shift as the transmission window shifts from the green to the green-blue and then finally over into the blue. One other thing is just like with naturally irradiated green diamonds, with these, we can also see green to brown radiation stains. the radiation stains in these blue diamonds is still green. The radiation stain isn't blue just because the body color is blue. The mechanisms that cause the radiation stains to be green still is present within these irradiated blue diamonds as well. So what is happening here that caused the irradiation, and where does it happen within the within the diamond's history? The diamond goes through a lot throughout its million to billion years life. It's when it's deep in the earth, it incorporates other impurities, incorporates other crystal inclusions, and then it's brought up rapidly and sometimes violently to the surface of the earth by these kimberlites. But then once it's in that near surface region, the earth has decided it wants to add on a little more to this diamond story, wants to add on an epilogue to what the diamond has encountered within the earth. And that's with natural radiation. And we know that that has to happen within the near surface region because there's a very limited temperature window in which this green to blue color is stable within the diamond. If the diamond is heated up to greater than 600 degrees Celsius, and that's at the upper limit, it's really closer to about 400 or 500 degrees Celsius, in which you start to lose body color within the stone. But at a maximum of 600 degrees Celsius, you will lose that color. So that's how we know that if a diamond is still green or blue, then it has to have, that color has to have been imparted within the shallow depths of the earth. As if it had been at higher temperatures and greater depths, that color would not have been preserved. One other interesting thing is that we're trying, one of the continuing issues with natural diamonds to try and tell the difference between natural radiation and laboratory radiation. And so this is one interesting thing related to radiation stains. And you can tell that the image on the right is certainly an artificial radiation stain that was done within a laboratory. And we can look at the way that this, the depth profile of this artificial radiation stain, as it looks very different from a natural radiation stain. When we look at the depth profile for a natural radiation stain, we can see that it starts to change as we go, start from the surface, and then as we go into the depth of the diamond, we see a transition in both the Raman position and in the full width half maximum. And that changes across the depth as we go, and we don't even have to go in too far. It's only about 30 microns. So much less than the width of a hair is where we see this transition. And we can see something very different from the depth profile of these artificial radiation stains, because those are imparted into the diamond at one fixed energy. Those are present at a fixed precise depth within the beneath the surface of the diamond. So this is one way that we can tell the difference between natural and artificial radiation stains. I'm gonna then spend a couple minutes talking about diamonds that are colored by these micro inclusions. Now, these fancy gray diamonds, these really are close cousins to fancy white and fancy black diamonds. Both of those are colored by nanometer to micrometer sized inclusions, and these fancy gray diamonds are as well. So since we're not looking in these diamonds, we're not looking at specific absorption features that bring about the color of the stone, the absorption spectra are not too helpful or too diagnostic for these types of stones for us. Instead, we really need to look in the microscope and see the inclusions and the micro inclusions within the microscope. So that's what we're showing here. This on the upper left, we're showing a thin plate of a sample that we got from the Merengue mines, and we cut into a thin slice to do some research work on it. And if we look at this transition between a gray region and a colorless region, we can see what is present within that gray region. And we can see clouds of these microscopic graphitic inclusions. And that's what's causing the gray color that we're seeing within this diamond. And sometimes that those graphite inclusions can be far larger, or and create a deeper gray color as well, almost a black. We did an interesting heating experiment where we took one of these slices and we have a region that is gray colored due to those graphitic inclusions, and then a region that is colorless because those did not go into that section. And so if we look at a microscopic image of the gray portion, we can see that the inclusion size of the graphite is less than 1 micron. We heated this diamond up to about 1400 degrees Celsius, and we can see that the graphite started causing the surrounding diamond to transform from diamond to graphite, and it made each of those little graphite grains slightly larger. So at 1400 degrees Celsius, when we heated in hydrogen, that inclusion size went from less than 1 micron to about 3 to 4 microns. And then when we heated it at 1700 degrees Celsius, you can see that they're far more pronounced. You can see the hexagonal morphology for these graphite grains much better. And you can see that the entire diamond looks black now because the graphite grains are so large that it's now creating not a cloud of tiny nano inclusions or micro inclusions. We're now seeing a full complement of that's turned it black. So I'm gonna switch gears now, and I'm gonna do a comparison among these four causes. What we did was we took 500 randomly selected diamonds within this color range from our database, and we looked at all of their IR absorption spectra, we looked at their visible absorption spectra, and looked to see what was creating the color in all of those, and then chronicling them against all of their grading quality factors. And so what we're showing along the x-axis is we're showing the body color of each of these diamonds. And then along the y-axis, we're seeing what the participation is for each of these causes of color within that hue. So for example, for diamonds that are colored green-blue, 100% of those are colored by GR1. And that is probably be expected from what we discussed earlier. For diamonds that are straight blue, have no other additional color modifiers, about 60% of those are colored by boron. A significant percentage are also colored by GR1. Those are mostly among the lighter saturations. And then a very small percentage are colored by hydrogen. I'm going to contrast that with diamonds that are a straight gray color. You can see that a very low percentage of those, about 10%, are colored by boron. The vast majority of those are colored by hydrogen, and then you have a little bit of percentage that are colored by inclusions. And then let's look at these overall within this color grade. Now we normally think, when we think of blue diamonds, we normally think of type 2Bs, those that are colored by boron. But when we look at the overall statistics, only for diamonds within this color range, only about a third of them are actually colored by boron. We also have a decent participation for those as well that are colored by GR1 or those that are colored by the hydrogen. And again, it'll be interesting in a few years to see after the Argyle mine has been closed to see what that impact of for these hydrogen diamonds has on the overall contribution. Now, this slide shows those same 500 diamonds, but instead of looking at the body color or the hue of the diamond, I'm looking at the saturation of it and looking to see what are the causes of color and how those are distributed among the saturations. So for those that have a very light saturation, typically those are ones that are colored by GR1 or perhaps by hydrogen, but the real story is when we're looking at these intense, fancy vivid, fancy deep. Those that are colored by boron really dominate these categories. So when we're looking at the really beautiful blue diamonds with very intense color, by and large, it's gonna be something that is colored by boron. It's also gonna be one that's most likely to have a pure blue hue. And so that's one of the reasons why the boron is, while it may not, only account for one third of the diamonds in this color category overall, the best and most beautiful examples of diamonds within this color range are invariably going to likely include boron. And then I want to give a brief recap on what are the diamond types. We talk about diamond types a lot in these talks, and it always helps to just give a refresher. We've talked a lot about type 2B diamonds because anything that has boron, detectable boron, is going to be classified as a type 2B. And if it has aggregated nitrogen, then it's going to be classified as a type 1A. And if the nitrogen is low enough, we can then classify what are the forms of the aggregates, whether they're A aggregates or B aggregates. If the nitrogen is saturated, then we'll just classify it as a type 1A without the additional A aggregate, B aggregate designation. And then if a diamond doesn't have any detectable nitrogen and no detectable boron, then we classify it as a type 2A. And the reason why I am revisiting that here is so I can put together this slide, where I'm looking at the cause of color versus the diamond type. And it's certainly for those that are classified, were classified as type 2B, 100% of those certainly get their color from boron. Those that are type 2A, no detectable nitrogen, no detectable boron, but it's blue in color, those are all colored by the GR1, by irradiation. Remember, these don't, in order for it to be blue, it can't have the nitrogen related defects absorbing in the blue. So we overwhelmingly, any diamond that is blue and colored by GR1 is gonna have very low or no nitrogen. Conversely, those diamonds that are type 1A have saturated nitrogen, where we can't even tell if it's A aggregates or B aggregates. Overwhelmingly, those are diamonds colored by hydrogen. So it's just really interesting that you can take an IR absorption spectrum on one of these diamonds, and based on the diamond type, you can have a pretty good hypothesis of what the cause of color is. You know, whether it's a 2A, then it's likely colored by GR1. If it's a saturated 1A, then it's likely colored by hydrogen. And then over here on the right, I'm just showing the distribution for the hue or the body color for these diamonds across the different diamond types. For the type 2B and type 2A, overwhelmingly we see a pure blue hue. And for the type 1A diamonds, we start to see a lot more gray coloration. So I want to finish this talk by just mentioning a couple things. One is to showcase the Blue Moon of Josephine. That has the world record price for the highest dollar value per carat at 4 million. And then this is a photo that was taken several years ago when we were studying the Hope Diamond at the Smithsonian. And certainly while they're definitely very interesting to study scientifically, and there's still a lot of mysteries to determine about a lot of these characteristics, they certainly remain these enchanting, timeless treasures. And just wonderful and beautiful to look at. So with that, I'm gonna finish it out and ask Evan to throw some questions.
Well, thank you, Sally, for that incredible overview. We've had a lot of questions rolling in. I've been doing my best to answer some of them, but I've left the best ones for you.
Okay.
So one of the questions that struck me as interesting was a question about silicon in the diamond. So you spent some time talking about boron and nitrogen that substitutes into the diamond lattice. But what about silicon, and does that ever substitute into diamonds?
Well, we don't see silicon very often in natural diamonds. We can see it rarely detected. We don't see it very often in natural diamonds. We do see it detected quite a bit in HPHT grown synthetic diamonds, and overwhelmingly mostly in the CVD grown diamonds. So it's not a big impact on diamonds that we see that are naturally grown, although it can be a major cause of color for CVDs. In fact, there are some CVD grown diamonds that are blue in color due to very high amounts of silicon, and due to absorption that's created by the neutral silicon vacancy peak at up in the infrared. So we can get blue color within a CVD grown diamond due to massive quantities of silicon that's imparted as part of that growth process. But in natural diamonds, it's not a major issue.
Interesting. Okay, we had a bunch of questions about phosphorescence. People were interested in the phosphorescence, especially of the Hope diamond. I think it's pretty chilling to see just how strong that eerie phosphorescence is. So one of the questions was about just how do you actually measure the phosphorescence or measure a spectrum of the phosphorescence?
Yes, what we do is I showed a photo where we had a probe up against the Hope diamond, and that is collecting the emission that's given off by the Hope diamond while it's phosphorescing. And we collect a spectrum over 1 second, and then we collect a spectrum over the next second, and so on, to create that that compilation of the intensities. And so once we turn the UV light off, we start to collect those spectra. And it was really interesting because before we had done that study at the Smithsonian, these phosphorescence had been observed many times for the Hope diamond and for others, but it had never really been chronicled before or had the phosphorescence spectra collected. And from that, we learned that there are a lot more diamonds that show that red phosphorescence that may not be visible. It may be too weak compared to the blue band. So you may see the blue band, but not the contribution of the red. And then there are also times where in throughout history, if someone saw a diamond that had red phosphorescence, they would try to say that it was a sister diamond to the Hope, because they thought that if it had the red phosphorescence like the Hope, then it must have been from the same rough as the Hope. But this study that we did included a number of the blue diamonds that were from the Aurora Butterfly Collection and that were also on permanent exhibit with the Smithsonian. That was one of the really early studies that were done regarding phosphorescence. And what we chronicled was that almost every blue diamond that we looked at would have the 500 band, the 660 band, but oftentimes both. Even if you couldn't see it with your eye, the spectrometer would be able to detect it.
Yeah, interesting. You've seen the phosphorescence firsthand from the Hope diamond, right?
Yes, I should mention that before I started looking at gem diamonds, I was looking a lot at the engineering applications of CVD grown diamonds. That was my doctoral dissertation and my postdoc. And I was doing that at the Naval Research Lab in DC. And they asked if we would be interested to collaborate on this project with the Smithsonian. And that was my first foray into gem diamonds. And so once I saw the Hope diamond, I was hooked on gems and I had to study them full time ever since. So yeah, I got to look at that and study it firsthand.
Yeah, pretty interesting. Okay, there's also some questions about sort of the proportions of different colors and the defects responsible for them. For instance, for blue diamonds, are most blue diamonds colored by boron, or what other causes are there and what are the proportions there? If you just see a blue diamond, can we take a good guess as to what the color cause is there?
Well, you can probably get a good guess from looking at the, from looking at the infrared absorption spectrum, if it's, or from looking at, certainly at the the visible absorption spectrum as well. There's a lot of the causes of color correlate very well with the diamond type. Overall, about one third of the diamonds that are colored by boron, that are blue, gray, or violet, are colored by boron, only about one third. So there are significant percentages that are colored by GR1 or by these hydrogen-related defects. And it will be interesting to see in the coming years what the impact is of argyle, whether the percentage that are colored by hydrogen will decrease as the argyle mine, after the argyle mine is closed.
Yeah. So in blue diamonds, these type 2B blue diamonds, sometimes we talk about a range from blue to gray.
Right.
And that gray, as I understand, is a bit different from the gray that's caused by hydrogen.
Yes.
Is there a way to tell those apart visually, or do you need to do something else to sort of suss out what's going on?
Yeah, from looking at it visually, it might be very difficult to tell the difference between a gray-blue diamond that is colored by boron and a gray-blue diamond that is colored by hydrogen. It may be difficult to look and to see those differences visually, but there are some differences. For example, type 2B diamonds, those will often show some electrical conductivity because of the boron is very close to the valence band and can impart some conductivity to the diamond. And that's used a lot for some of the engineering applications for CVD grown or HPHT grown diamond, not so much for natural diamond, but you can look at the electrical conductivity also and determine if a diamond is type 2B.
Okay, and one more thing about the hydrogen and sort of the appearance of violet colors.
Yeah.
The question just about what is the cause of violet colors? I think there might have been some confusion between, as I understand, there's sort of a violet range that's due to hydrogen and maybe a more purplish to pinkish range that has to do with plastic deformation. Could you sort of help us differentiate between those two? Is that right?
Well, there are some type 2B diamonds that will have a violetish coloration. Those are very rare. Often those are also colored by plastic deformation. We'll often see those within a gray, violet, and color continuum. For those that are colored by hydrogen, they have a very low percentage if you look at the GIA color grade, because GIA does the grading under daylight conditions. And the violet coloration is far more enhanced when you look at it under incandescent light. And that brings about the Alexandrite effect that I was mentioning earlier, in which something can look a gray-blue under daylight and have a color graded gray-blue, but then when you look at it under incandescent light, it looks far more violet. So violet diamonds are actually very rare. They're probably the rarest of the pure colors, probably more rare than dance, you know, straight orange or straight purple. I think straight violet is one of the rarest colors that we see. And certainly with that would not have a gray coloration. So they're definitely very rare in order to get a straight violet color call. But if you look at these in incandescent light, then you can get more of that violet coloration to be seen.
Wow. That's great. So I think that's about it for now. We'll wrap up the questions. But if you do have any further lingering questions, please do find us on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, or the GIA website. And join us again next week, where we'll be joined by Rose Tozer for a knowledge session on superstitions surrounding gems and jewelry. And thank you again to Dr. Sala Magaña for this excellent presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Smith.
And for everyone out there watching, thanks for joining us.